Good afternoon. I have some cool data to show you on college students. Wish I'd heard your talk before. But first, I want to congratulate Dan on his recent big awards that APA and APS gave him. Also mention the award that's only got mentioned a little bit. He's about to be inducted into the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, which is kind of a cool honor because they also give it to non-academics, to actors and writers and musicians and whatnot. And you get to hobnob with these guys. In fact, this time Dan will get to hobnob with some of these guys. Now, if you didn't recognize all these people, I'll show you their album covers, and you might. The essential Dave Brubeck, the essential Bob Dylan, the essential Paul Simon, and of course, the essential Dan Wegner. Now, before you start turning your iPhone on to order this on iTunes, it's not quite out yet. But Dan has been mixing music CDs in his basement for a long time, and I think it's coming soon. One of the reasons that Dan has gotten awards is because of his books. And I wanted to mention one of the books that should not be forgotten. It's actually his first book, and really his most financially successful, I expect. I think that because I had hundreds and hundreds of undergraduates ordering this book for years and years and years. It was a wonderful book, published in 1977 with Robin Baliker, full of interesting things about social psychology. It was all about the implicit rules and implicit beliefs and assumptions that we have that regulate our social inferences and our social behavior. It was written in an outrageous style that only he and Robin could pull off. So that was 35 years ago when Dan sort of entered my mind as I read this book, first as a source of creative ideas and then later as a friend. And we've done a number of interesting things together over the years. One of the more fun things was to do some sailing on the Chesapeake Bay. You may not know it, but Dan is he's very interested in boats and water. He's a very creative guy, we all know that. But boats is actually not something for which creativity and divergent thinking work well. Well, Gilbert said we're supposed to talk about science, so let me do that. I have some neat data. Let me give you a little background. This is about affect as information about resources. About 60 years ago, Jerome Bruner proclaimed the new look in perception. And the essence of the idea was that our perception of the physical world is influenced by our motivation and our emotion. It's an idea that perception psychologists hate. And if you mention that today, you're likely to get an anxiety attack on the part of a perception psychologist. It was roundly rejected for a variety of reasons. But now it turns out, if you look at data by Hank Arts, for example, he was right. We also have some data on the slant of hills that is similar to that kind of data. That is, if you put somebody at the bottom of a hill and you play sad music on an iPod to them, the hill seems to be steeper than for people that hear happy music. Or if you stand them on top of the hill and have them look down the hill, oh, they're standing on a skateboard, I should mention, so they're mildly fearful, the hill also seems to get steeper than if they're standing on a box the same height. And in fact, the more fear they report, the steeper it gets. And it's not just self-report, they also are trying to measure it with a kind of protractor, and you get the same results. Now, my colleague, Dennis Proffitt, a perception psychologist whose paradigm this is, has also shown that the elderly or people who are physically exhausted from exercise or carrying a heavy backpack all show this kind of the hill gets steeper effect. And those variables make it look like it's a matter of resources. In fact, Prophet has a whole point of view about perception in which he suggests that perception really is for action and ultimately for that our behavior, like the behavior of all the other animals on Earth, is about managing resources. A former postdoc of mine, Simona Schnall, who's also already been mentioned before, did a nice experiment after we heard Baumeister talk about glucose. She went and tried the hill study with glucose. So after people were depleted, she replenished their glucose and the hill got less steep, reinforcing the idea that maybe it is about resources. Cooler than that, she showed that you get the same effect if you just have a friend show up, extending the idea to social resources. Well, okay, we're entertaining currently the idea of affect as information about the demands on and the availability of bodily and social resources. So we did an experiment in which we said, well, we want to see how this works. So we manipulated affect, mood states, happy and sad states, as information about resources, perhaps, and actual resources, glucose. And I'll show you this, the one graph I'm going to show you. If you'll see here on the y-axis is the perceived slant of the hill. On the x-axis, we measured blood glucose before and after. We gave them one or another kind of drink. Some people lost glucose over the course of the experiment. Some people gained glucose. There is, as I said, also happy, sad mood. And here are the nice orderly results across the 10 levels of change in glucose for the happy mood people. Now, it makes sense, as you see on the left, the people who have lost glucose say, ooh, the hill is really steep. And the people on the right who have gained glucose say, not so steep. What about the sad mood folks? Well, they're also very orderly. As you see, they do the opposite of what the happy mood people do. Well, we find that often, that the sad mood does the opposite of the happy mood. But if you look at this, this is pretty strange. They're saying, if you look in the left-hand lower blue bars there, they're saying, the less glucose I've got, the more manageable the hill is. And on the right, the more glucose I've got, the steeper the hill. We were perplexed. But this is a study about affect as information about resources. And what it turned out to be an experiment about, we think, is the how good is that information? On the bottom here, you see where people think the hill is not steep, the information is reliable. The sad affect said, you've lost glucose. And indeed, they had lost glucose, good information. On the right, the happy mood said, you've gained glucose. And indeed, they had gained glucose. But the other folks who thought the hill looked pretty steep, on the left, the happy mood said, you've gained glucose. But they'd actually lost glucose. And the blue bars on the right said, you've lost glucose, but they'd gained glucose. So it looks like if affect serves as information about resources, that when their affect and glucose were consistent, they have reliable information. The hill looks manageable. But if it's inconsistent, they have unreliable information, they're going to provisionally treat hills as steep. They can't afford to invest resources when they don't know what the budget is. Now, this whole glucose thing turned out to be kind of an interesting emergent subject in social psychology. Carol Dweck and company recently published an interesting paper in which they showed that these ego depletion effects occur primarily for people who believe that self-control is depleting. And you get these glucose-fixing effects if you believe in this. Well, now, this doesn't cast doubt on the finding at all, But I think what it suggests is that it's not about glucose in the first instance. It's about the budgeting or the predictability of resources. Turns out, by the way, well, it's all about anticipation. And it turns out that even if you do one of these glucose studies, you have people drink a glucose drink, they can just swish it in their mouth and spit it out, and you get the same effect. Whoa, what's going on here? Well, there are receptors in the mouth that basically tell the brain, hey, looking good. You can spend some glucose. It's coming in. Turns out the dopamine system also acts in a similar way. It's really about anticipation of a great meal, not actually eating the meal that fires up or the idea that you're going to have a good meal fires up the dopamine. Anyway, so our point is, the key seems to be information about resources, not actual resources. That just as in the market, decisions to invest resources reflect affective anticipation. Thank you.